our books for bringing and organizing the tour for Muhammad. I would like also to thank Dr. Deborah Little, Dr. Devin Thornburg, the Student Council, and the Office of Diversity and Inclusion, led by Dr. Perry Green, the Vice President of Diversity and Inclusion. Without their support and hard work, this event wouldn't have happened. On behalf of us all, too, I would like to thank you for joining us today. You might ask, what does this event have to do with today's conference? Well, the discussion about Palestine is relevant to the American people for so many reasons. For one, Israel is one of the largest recipients of U.S. foreign aid. According to Mark Toner, a State Department spokesman, U.S. aid to Israel is, a quote, more than any other nation, totaling $3.1 billion this year. This corresponded in 2016 to $9.8 million per day of American taxpayers' money. This financial commitment is not unique to the present administration. It was established throughout past presidencies and was strengthened during the Obama administration. Interestingly, Donald Trump's America First budget proposal maintained that amount of aid given to Israel, even while including deep cuts in foreign aid in other nation states across the board. Not to mention the deep cuts at home to crucial programs, including Meals on Wheels, National Endowment for Arts and Sciences, the Environmental Protection Agency, and to the budgets of the Labor Department and State Department. Secondly, so much of what Americans know about Palestine may be impacted by what is now referred to as alternative facts. This has been an ongoing feature of the Palestinian narrative, whereby Palestinian voices and histories have been repeatedly misrepresented or even silenced. So Palestine might be a good case study to learn from as more and more areas of policy become subject to this administration's unusual relationship with the truth. Thirdly, and perhaps most importantly, the narrative of Palestinian people are in a sense no different than the narratives of so many other oppressed communities in the US, narratives of demonization, militarized policing, disposition of lands, racism and oppression. These constructs shape the lives of Palestinians, and they also shaping the lives of many American communities, the First Nations, descendants of slaves and black communities, Asian American communities, Latino communities, and all people who are once again being stigmatized because of their gender, their sexuality, their religious beliefs, or their ethnic origin. Many present the Israel-Palestine issue as a controversial issue for debate, but it is my hope that today's event will bring into focus something that is not debatable: the undebatable humanity of Palestinians under occupation and segregation, and the non-controversial humane duty of each one of us to stand together and rise up against racist and supremacist policies, no matter who issues them and no matter who is affected. This presentation concerns a topic that connects us all as humans, art, and its impact. Art as a means of resistance, art as a tool for survival, as a way to maintain the humanity of those living under oppression when all they are faced with is in their daily experiences, is dehumanization, lack or limited access, systemic racism, and stereotyping. Art may enable people under oppression to imagine, to seek a different reality for themselves, a reality in which they live as equals and in which social justice is the ruling principle. Art may facilitate internal discussions for social evolution and development within oppressed communities, since oppressed communities are not to be fossilized. Art, for me and for so many individuals who consume the art, may be a space to breathe when feeling suffocated under political and military forces. Art may enable us to take a deep breath under the weight of the bans and structures and injustices that incarcerate our kids and imprison our spirits. Art may be a place to let your body stretch for a second after experiencing painful restrictions of limited access, cheap labor, and stereotyping. A place for a voice of pain to shout from. A place to express all the painful histories and trauma we undergo since being formed in the womb. But also, Art is a safe place for us to feel joy and to laugh together as a community, a place for us to feel powerful in our unity, a place for us to find anchor when we are adrift, to get our heads together when all we can see are the shattered pieces of values and beliefs mixed with realities and imposed logic, hope mixed with despair and anger. That's art to me, the non-artist, the human way of the spirit to rise up. In that context, I'm honored to introduce Mohammed Sabani. Mohammed is a Palestinian political cartoonist. He lived in Kuwait and currently resides in Ramallah in the occupied West territories. He has been working for Al-Hayah Al-Jadida, a daily newspaper, since 2002. In February 2013, Mohammed was jailed by the Israeli authorities without charge for 5 months. Charges of contact with enemy were made later, only after an international campaign for his release. He was jailed in prison cell number 28. He didn't stop drawing while being in prison. In fact, cell number 28 became a theme of one of his exhibits. Mohammed was also censored by authorities within his community, the Palestinian Authority in the West Bank and Hamas in Gaza, for his drawings of leaders and what seemed like a depiction of religious figures. Mohammed didn't concede to any of the attempts to control him and stayed loyal to himself as a free artist, depicting the pain, lives, questions, and wonders of the Palestinian mind and heart in its utmost purity. His brush is speaking the Palestinian narrative and shaping a future in which freedom, equity, justice will be prominent. Mohammed has won several awards and has presented in numerous exhibits around the world, including Asia, Europe, and the US. But I want to point out for his first award, because he got it in 1986 when he was just 6 years old, when he entered a contest in Kuwait. Art and cartooning is his passion, and he has been producing unique cartoons worthy of awards since that time. Can you imagine? He's just an extraordinary, passionate artist at heart. It seems very fitting for me to be referred to the words of Martin Luther King's speech today against the war in Vietnam, when it was not the common stand that many people took. Dr. King said that he made that stand because his conscience left him no other choice. I hope you listen to Mohammed this afternoon with your conscience, and that you listen for the assertion of the humanity in all of us, and see him in us and us in him, because we are all but one, humans in this world in search of meaning in our lives. Please join me in welcoming Mohammed Sabani. So we're going to have Mohammed present for half an hour, and then we'll be open for questions.
Thank you for this nice introducing for me. First.